So I'll just get right to it. This talk is also about valuing actions, but this time using interpretable models. So a little something about me first. So I'm Tom. I'm a member of the DTI lab in Leuven. I'm a member of Peter who talked this morning. A colleague of Peter who talked this morning. So I'm a PhD student in machine learning, artificial intelligence, and luckily also football analytics. I briefly worked on ads recommendation at Facebook. As was mentioned, I published some papers at a number of data science conferences. And also, some of you may have read this in the news lately, that we were a team that were behind determining who was better between Messi and Ronaldo, although this was just run on our laptop. I don't know where they got the supercomputer from, but that's just how the media works, right? So this talk is about valuing on-the-ball actions. So why would you want to do this? Well, the problem is that most existing football stats value only a single type of action. So the perfect example of this is the famous expected goals. But so if you're focusing on expected goals, you're using 2% of your data and ignoring the other 98%. So the idea is, can we find a way to value all actions? So our solution for this is a framework called VAPE. And this is our idea to value all on-the-ball actions. It's not exactly new. So valuing actions has actually become quite a hot topic in the recent years. So I'm thinking Tom Lawrence will probably talk also a little bit about these later on today. So we've been working on this roughly since start of 2017. But there's a lot of parallel work here. And I think actually all these things are kind of addressing the same issue, but just using different methodologies to basically get to valuing more actions than just goals and assists. So outline of my talk today. So I'm hoping that if you pay attention, you'll have learned five things, namely why event stream data is hard to analyze, how you can value actions using our VAPE framework, why you should not use area under the RSI curve, and then finally how to value actions using an extremely simple interpretable model and then a slightly more advanced but still interpretable model. So first things first, why event stream data is hard to analyze, and that includes StatsBomb's data in my opinion. So those of you that are that know this data are aware that it describes events in a football match. So it's an incredibly rich data source, but there are a number of problems with it in my opinion. So the first thing is that you have very vendor-specific terminology. Like StatsBomb now has the concept of a carry. As far as I know, that doesn't really exist in the other data sources. So basically what this means is that whenever you're writing code to process one kind of data, you can't apply it to data from other vendors. The second problem, I'd say, is that there are some useless events sometimes in the event stream. So I know StatsBomb records the start and end of halves. So I'm sure there's a use case for that somewhere, but I haven't really encountered it yet. And then the final thing, the problem that I have with the data is something called which I like to call optional information snippets, which are often represented as deep nested JSON dictionaries. So Ted mentioned this morning that StatsBomb is a really, is the most advanced data stream format yet. So I agree with that, but I think what he didn't mention is that the more complex you're making your data, you're also adding engineering costs to actually processing that data and filtering it out. I think all of you in the room who have worked with this can probably attest to that it's often not that easy to actually get the specific information from the data that you're looking for. And especially because of these optional information snippets, there's often the problem that there might be interesting information in there that you care about, but you just don't know that it's in there because it's not fixed. So our solution for this is something Peter already briefly introduced this morning. It's an event stream data format called SPADL, which stands for Soccer Player Action Description Language, and it has a number of advantages. So the first thing is that it unifies event data from various vendors. So it's kind of like a layer on top of Opta, Wyscout, and StatsBomb. And it's more simple, but yeah, then you have the advantage that you can basically plug in one data source and replace it by another one. So we focus exclusively on on-the-ball actions. So all the events that we don't really care about, we throw them out. And then the biggest benefit, in my opinion, is that we store the same 8 attributes per action. So this has the advantage that you always know exactly what kind of information you have. And also, you can store this in just a simple table, not in like a JSON document. And converters from Opta, Wisecout, and StatsBomb data to this format are freely available online. Check this out if you're interested in this. I think for people just starting in football analytics, this is an easier format to like get your hands dirty for the first time than immediately starting with like the full JSON documents. Okay. So, second lesson, how to value actions. So, using our framework. So the challenge is that most actions do not affect the score. So a football game contains roughly 1,600 actions, depending on your data provider, that could be a bit more or a bit less, but let's say 1,600. And as far as I know, the most common final score in soccer is 1-0. So what this means is you have one goal that you know that was probably a pretty good action, and then 1,599 actions you actually know nothing about. So questions like what is the value of an action, or another question, how good is a player, these are quite high-level questions with no real objective ground truth. So that's something, that's a big challenge that we have to deal with. So an example of this is, so this is a pass from Messi to Busquets. So there you go, the pass. And then, okay, was this a good action? Was this a bad action? We don't know because it didn't directly cause a goal. So the only thing we do know about this action is that it moved the game from one state to another state. And that is something that we can actually use. So our VAPE framework, which stands for Valuing Actions by Estimating Probabilities, values actions by their expected impact on the score. So what do we mean by that? So the intuition is that a good action for a specific team should increase the short-term probability of scoring a goal and or decrease the short-term probability of conceding a goal. And we have a formula called the VAPE formula, which does nothing more than just put this intuition into actual mathematical terms. So it's just you have the delta, your gain in probability of scoring, which is just the probability of scoring from one game state minus the probability of scoring in the other game state. And then the same thing for conceding. So this formula actually seems rather simple, but it's actually really powerful because also as Peter already mentioned this morning, what it allows you to do is to go from like a subjective thing, like valuing actions, to a very objective machine learning task, which is estimating the probability of future events in an event stream. Our work on this, this is basically the biggest contribution in our paper at KDD this summer. So you might kind of recognize this slide also from this morning. So we have our machine learning task, and you basically need three ingredients to complete the task. You need your features, you need your labels, and you need a classifier to predict the labels from the features. So the features that describe a game state are the exact same features that Peter mentioned this morning. You have more simple features, which are just these attributes directly fed into the classifier. Then we have more complex features, which is when we're starting to this is where you can like try to engineer interesting features and really incorporate domain knowledge you have about soccer. And then finally, the context features, like the goal difference between the different teams. So now we have a lot of interesting features about game states. Then the next thing we need are labels that capture the limited temporal influence of a game state. So you might, again, recognize this figure. So what we think is that if you have a specific game state and shortly afterwards a goal happens, then probably that game state helped make that goal happen, while if it happened 10 minutes later, then probably that game state had nothing to do with it. So using this, we come up with two different labels because we need a label to predict the odds of scoring and we need a label to predict the odds of conceding. And it's just one if the team scores in the next 10 actions. So here, 10 is a parameter of the approach, and you like if you were to disagree with me on what this parameter would be, you could easily adjust it in the framework. So, okay, great. Now we have our features, we have our labels. All that's left to do is to pick a specific classifier. There are a number of classifiers you could choose. A very popular one and a simple one is logistic regression, or you could also go for something more fancy like HD boost. So the question is, how do you choose the best one? Well, I have an opinion on that, and the opinion is that you should not use exclusively area under the ROC curve, and you should do something else. And I'm going to demonstrate this with like a little thought experiment based on shots. So I think most of you know that roughly 1 in 10 shots ends in a goal. So here are 10 random shots, and we know one of them ended in a goal, and the other 9 did not. So imagine you now have 2 models that are trying to predict for each shot the probability of it ending up in a goal. So you have your model A, which is, let's say, incredibly optimistic and thinks that each shot has over a 90% chance of becoming a goal. And then you have another model called B, which gives somewhat more realistic probabilities. So if you were to have to put one of these models into production, raise your hand if you would choose model A. Okay, no one. Raise your hand if you would choose model B. A couple of you, that's cool. So you are absolutely correct. However, if you were to purely evaluate these models using area under the ROC curve, you would see that model A actually achieves a way better performance than model B. So that's in a nutshell why I think you should not exclusively use this metric. And you should definitely use something else, which is called the Brier score, or which is actually just the mean squared error over your predictions. And using this score, you can actually see that model A is 10 times worse than model B actually predicting goal chances. So you may have noticed that this slide is missing a title. So here's the title. Area under the ROC curve is a ranking metric. You're basically throwing away the actual predictions and just ranking your shots in terms of which one was the most likely one to become a goal, while Brier score is a proper scoring rule. So there's one slight issue with Brier score, which is that it's less interpretable than area under the ROC curve. It's just, it gives you an error rate, but like, is this error rate, is it good, is it bad? You don't really know. There's like nothing to really compare it to. So I also have a small solution for this. It's something which I like to call the normalized Brier score, and it shows the improvement over a naive baseline. So if we know that 1 out of 10 shots ends in a goal, what's the simplest baseline you can use? It's actually just predicting a 10% chance of scoring a goal. And what you can then do, you can estimate the Brier score of that specific baseline, and then you can divide your score from your more complicated model by the baseline. And in this, you can see that model A is 900 times worse than the simple baseline, while model B has an improvement over it of, say, roughly 11%. So this makes it a bit more interpretable, I'd say. And you might be surprised on like how some complicated models sometimes barely beat this really simple baseline. So that's always a really good sanity check. Okay, great. Now we have our classifiers and we have a way to evaluate them. So what we did is we trained the classifiers on one season of Premier League data, and we tested them on another season of Premier League data. And as it turns out, that logistic regression gives a bit less than 90% normalized Brier score, and XGBoost gives 85.6% normalized Brier score. So XGBoost is clearly the winner, and we should pick XGBoost here, right? Well, this is basically where our KDD paper stops. And the next question we asked ourselves is, okay, but why is XGBoost better? Or to put it in more general terms, why does our model think an action is particularly good or particularly bad? So I'm now going to take a small step back, and we're going to pretty much ignore 5 years of sports analytics research, and we're going to just go back to the basics and just predict the odds of scoring a goal in the near future purely based on location data. So just your X and Y coordinates. And the label is, will you score in the near future, yes or not? So if we use this, then we see, okay, logistic regression, as you can see, is already a much smaller gain over the baseline, but still XGBoost is 2% better. So that's not so, but the problem is logistic regression is interpretable, but XGBoost is not. So the question is, can we try to get XGBoost performance while keeping the interpretability of logistic regression? And the answer is maybe, So there are these fun models called generalized additive models, which Lucas actually mentioned this this morning, and they're kind of a generalization of logistic regression. So some, for those of you that are a bit more aware of the inner workings of logistic regression, you'll know that it's a linear model. So as you can see here, it just tests, okay, the closer you are on the X, so the closer you are to the back line of the opponent, the higher your odds of scoring. And your y-coordinates doesn't really matter that much. So, and this is linear. What generalized additive models does is it has a similar working, but now instead of just using one weight, we can fit a non-linear function on this. So, these are the formulas, but formulas are boring, so let's put them on a figure. So these figures here show both the logistic regression and the generalized additive models. So the orange line is just the straight logistic regression, and the blue lines are the generalized additive models. So you can already see a difference here with the x-coordinate, but especially with the y-coordinate, the difference is striking. Because, apparently, when you're more in front, when your y-coordinate is more in front of the goal, your odds of scoring are higher. So it seems like an obvious thing, but that is something that these generalized additive models are able to capture, which logistic regression are not able to capture. Because as you can see here, like if you try to fit this with only one weight, you basically end up with a weight of zero. So these are still really interpretable models, but they're actually quite powerful. So if we look at the performance of that model I showed you just now, we actually see that it has the exact same performance on our task as XGBoost. So these are fun models to play with. Now the next thing we can do is try going for a little bit more advanced interpretable models. So let's not ignore 5 years of sports analytic research now and use all the features we can imagine. So let's use a lot of features, all the features we can think of, and try to predict this label again. So so as you can see, the generalized additive models come pretty close to the performance of XGBoost. So now you might be thinking, okay, great, I now have a model I can interpret. I just have to look at these 155 different figures. So my idea is that is like, okay, it's, interpretable in theory, but how interpretable is a sum of 155 different functions really? So our idea was, okay, why don't we just use the 10 most important features and look at how much of a hit we're getting on our performance? So it actually turns out that there is a slight hit on performance, but it's reasonable. Our best score here is with XGBoost at 85.6% normalized prior score. And using just 10 features with the generalized additive models, we're only doing 0.5% worse, which is a reasonable approximation. So I'm now going to show you figures of the generalized additive model. So there are a number of location-based features. So you can clearly see the relation. Like this is the first one here. You can't see the slide. So basically, this first one here, this is your the distance of your location at that particular moment to the goal. As you can see, pretty important. The one at the bottom is the angle. So an angle of zero means that you're right in front of the goal. And an angle of 1.5 means that you're pretty much at the corner flag. So you just look at the actual features you have and you sum these whatever values you get. Then there are also some movement-based features. So these are all features that tell you how much you moved during the most recent action or the action before that or even the action before that. So as it turns out, our model picks up on the fact that if you counterattack fast, then your odds of scoring go up quite drastically. So the best actions are the ones where you're gaining a lot of ground, like you're getting 10 meters closer to the goal with every action. Then you also have a bit of the time factor at the bottom. And what this basically is telling you is that, the slower your actions, the more time there is in between, the lower your odds of scoring. And that holds for a certain moment until you get roughly over 40, And I think what this is picking up now on is that if there's more than 40 seconds between the last action and the current action, then that's probably more a new situation, like a free kick or something, because the time between consecutive actions within play shouldn't be that high. So the final three figures are categorical features. So there are three really simple ones. And they're saying that if your action was successful, your odds of scoring go up, which makes sense, because if you fail a pass, then you've lost the ball. And also, if you've committed a foul, then your odds of scoring drastically reduce, which, again, also makes sense. One that I think is pretty interesting is the goal score difference, and especially the difference between being two goals behind and three goals behind is actually quite surprising to me. So I think there is just something about being three goals behind that like breaks a player, where their actions just, you know, they stop trying and they just are not able to really, you know, do good actions anymore. And there's also like a difference between being three goals ahead or four goals ahead. And I think there's like another maybe mental difference there, where if you're three goals ahead, you're still kind of trying to play well. Well, if you're four goals ahead, you're, you know, yeah, okay, we've won this match. Let's just, you know, ease down and focus on and worry about the next game. So I've now shown you these 10 figures. And so what I want to stress is that like these 10 figures, these are the complete model. So you've just seen the entire model. You can print this on a piece of paper. You can give this to somebody. You can ask them, hey, this line here, does this make sense? Or should this be a little bit higher or a little bit lower? And just using this incredibly simple model, we were able to approximate reasonably well the performance of an XGBoost model with over 150 features that is totally not interpretable at all. So basically my message here is that if you're playing with these kind of models yourself, maybe give these general additive models a try and see if what you're learning is actually what you think, if what you think you are learning is actually what you are learning. So finally, some online resources. I think as I already mentioned, pretty much the entire pipeline from our KDD paper is online, and it just goes from the full pipeline from downloading the StatsBomb data to producing the action values and even rating, giving like you a top 10 list of the best players in a particular league. So if you want to play with these generalized additive models, Microsoft released a great Python package for this a couple of months ago. Or if you don't feel like coding at all, these action values are also online on the SciSports Insight platform. SciSports is a company we collaborate with quite a lot. Then some future work. We've also recently done some work on player vectors in which we try to quantify the playing style of a particular player in a couple of small vectors. And the characteristics of a particular player is something we've kind of been ignoring in our models for now, because you can't just put the ID of a player in there. That's way too sparse. But we want to see like what happens if we actually try to add the characteristics of a player to our VAPE models. So some concluding thoughts on football analytics in general. So there are a number of challenges. The one thing is that event stream data is hard to analyze, but I hope that using our simpler format, it's easier to just get up and running, get started, try something small. There's pretty much for all the things everybody's here trying to do, there's no real ground truth available. Everything we're trying to measure, we're just hoping that we're measuring what we're actually measuring. Valuing actions is a bit of a hot topic right now. I'm really looking forward to Tom Lawrence's talk. I get the feeling that five or six different people are pretty much working on the same thing parallel to each other. So, it might be worth actually collaborating a bit more on that. And then my final remark is, a bit of a question and a challenge to everybody here who's building these models. It's just, do you think you really understand your model? And that's basically my remark to finish on. Okay.